Hi, good morning all of you. So in the last class we discussed about relative angular velocity or the angular velocity in general. That means when a particle is in linear motion, how to define the angular velocity with respect to a particular observer, right? And when both the observer and particle are moving, then how to define the relative angular velocity. We discussed those quantities in our last class. Now in today class, let us see some the basic relations between linear and angular quantities. And then we define the types of accelerations or net acceleration in the circular motion. And we define the types of like uniform and non-uniform circular motion, right? And so first let us see this relation between linear and angular quantities there, or angular parameters you can call. Like suppose if a particle is moving in a circular path like this. Let us consider this particle is covering a small angular displacement here. Suppose it is traveling from this point P to point Q, let us consider. It's a small angular displacement I am taking here. So let us take this angular displacement as d theta. The angular displacement we are taking it as d theta, and radius of the circular path I am taking it as r. So now the linear displacement and angular displacement relation first I am writing here. The linear displacement is nothing but PQ, that's very small we are taking, and angular displacement is d theta. And so that the relation between them we can write this as, so now I can write this as linear displacement. So linear displacement is equal to PQ is equal to, that you can write this as r into d theta we can write. So the PQ value may consider as some s linear displacement. So I can write this as linear displacement PQ is equal to s is equal to r d theta you can write. So this is the relation between our linear displacement and angular displacement equation here. Let it be ds. So small displacement we are taking there, right? And so now this is the relation between small linear displacement and angular, the small corresponding small angular displacement there. And so now let us differentiate that equation to get this speed relation there. So that means that speed relation I can write this as here. So this is now ds by dt is equal to, so this one I can write this as d theta by r into d theta by dt you can write. So now this r into d theta by dt is nothing but this value you can write this as omega. The rate of change of angular displacement is nothing but our angular velocity, and this is the rate of change of displacement of the particle, that we can write this as our linear velocity, right? Or we can write this as speed here. Therefore that v is equal to r omega you can write. So this is the relation between linear speed and angular speed here. So now this v corresponds to the linear speed. So linear speed of the particle, and that omega is the angular speed of the particle. And you know, in vector form also you can express that. In vector form, if you write this in vector form, so this we already discussed in vector form, we already discussed in previous like cross product of the vector applications also. So in vector form we can write this as v bar is equal to omega bar cross r bar. So this is in vector form there. And next here we can differentiate this equation here. Suppose say this I am taking this as the equation 1, and let us take this as equation 2 here. And now again let us differentiate that equation 2, and so that you will get the acceleration relation there. That means now I am writing this as dv by dt. So dv by dt is equal to r into d omega by dt. And so now this dv by dt, actually we call that as v, means we are taking that as a speed. And so now the dv by dt is nothing but that gives the rate of change of speed. So that rate of change of speed we call that as tangential acceleration. So we name that as tangential acceleration. It is not the rate of change of velocity, it is a rate of change of speed or magnitude of velocity. So we name this as, therefore this tangential acceleration at is equal to dv by dt. So therefore this at is equal to, we can write this as r into alpha. You know this alpha is nothing but our angular acceleration there. So where alpha is d omega by dt, this we discussed already in our previous classes. Rate of change of angular velocity is nothing but angular acceleration, right? So now this is our say equation 3. So that means that is a linear acceleration and angular acceleration definitions there. That means or the relations. That means linear displacement is like r into angular displacement. Linear speed is nothing but, or speed is nothing but r into angular speed. Or the linear acceleration like at is nothing but, or we call that as tangential acceleration or linear acceleration. This we multiplying by this angular acceleration with the r, you will get this corresponding linear acceleration there. So that means simply for all of them, just we are multiplying corresponding angular parameter with the radius vector or the radius r, so that you will get the corresponding linear quantity you will get there, right? So that is relation between linear parameters and angular parameters here. And with these relations, now we can define this in the previous classes, like we discussed some angular velocity in general and relative angular velocity. So with the help of these relations, now we can discuss a few problems based on that angular velocity or relative angular velocity calculations. So let us say this. So here I am taking an example like say a particle is moving in a circular path of radius r here. So when it is here, the particle is A here, and this is the point O, and I am taking this is the point B, and here another point C is there here, right? So then this distance I am taking it as r radius, and this distance is also given as r. So now the angular velocity of the point A with respect to the point O will be omega, that is given there. So with respect to point B and with respect to point C, now we need to define there. So just write that a particle is moving in a circular path of radius r. A particle is moving in a circular path of radius r. When it is at point A, when it is at point A, its angular velocity with respect to the point O is omega. With respect to the point O is omega. Then at the instant shown in figure, find its angular velocity with respect to the point B and with respect to the point C. So now, first of all, with respect to the point O is given. That means I am writing this angular velocity of A with respect to the point O. So then, with respect to the point O, then this value I can write this as omega. And corresponding velocity we can write as V by R, you can write. Is it clear? So that means if omega is angular velocity, then corresponding speed I am taking here. The corresponding speed we can write as V by R, because just now we mentioned that relation as V is equal to R omega. And so from this I can write this V value is equal to R omega, you can write. So where omega is angular velocity of A with respect to O. Now I am writing this angular velocity. So that means angular velocity of A with respect to point B. So with respect to point B, I am writing here. So angular velocity of A with respect to point B, now we can define this as. So now our general definition is velocity by this perpendicular distance we need to write here. That is our general definition, what we defined in our previous classes. So angular velocity if you want to define. So now this value we can write this as velocity is V only, and this R perpendicular means with respect to point B means the distance between A and B we need to write. So which is 2r. And so then v means we can substitute that expression, or v by r directly you can write this as omega. And so then this value I can write this as omega by 2. So with respect to point O it is omega, but with respect to point B it is omega by 2. Now let us define similarly with respect to the point C. So this is angular velocity of A with respect to C. So the angular velocity of A with respect to C is equal to, again our formula is V by R perpendicular. So therefore now this expression you can write as again V by, that means you may substitute that expression there, R omega. By now R perpendicular means from here to here the distance we need to write, distance between point and the observer. Observer we need to take here. And so then that distance you can take this as 3R. And so then with respect to point C then you can write this as omega by 3. And so now we can observe that the angular velocities of a point or a point mass or the particles will be different about different points there. So with respect to one point you will get one angular velocity, and with respect to another point you will get the another angular velocity there, right? So now let us write another problem based on this. So now let us consider like this is the point A and this is the point B here. So they are moving with some velocities V, and this is the point O. So write that. The angular velocities of two particles A and B, revolving in a same circular path of radius r, is omega each with respect to the center, Find angular velocity of A with respect to B. When they are diametrically opposite to each other. That means the V is not given in the problem. To represent they are moving opposite each other, just I am representing that velocities as V. Omegas are given there. Omega is angular velocity of each particle with respect to the center is given for us. So V is not given. You need to define that V value by using this, right? So that we can write this as angular velocity of A with respect to O. So this value we can write this as V by R. So this value is given as for us O. We can write this as V is equal to R omega, or velocity of A as R omega. And similarly the velocity of B is also R omega, you can write here. So similarly I can say that this is velocity of B is equal to R omega, right? The linear speed. Now just you can write this relative angular velocity formula. By using that our relative angular velocity formula, you can write this angular velocity of A with respect to B. So now I can write this as angular velocity of A with respect to B. So angular velocity of A with respect to B means velocity of A with respect to B perpendicular to the line joining between those two particles, and then perpendicular distance between those two particles. That is our general definition of this relative angular velocities there. And so then this equation we can write this as their velocities are opposite each other, then V minus of minus V you need to write by 2R. So this is 2V by 2R you can write. And so which is our V by R. So then velocity of A and B we can take this as, this value only we are taking it as V actually there, right? Or you can substitute like V and VB you can substitute there, and you can write those values here. V and VB you can substitute here, that V and VB values are given by r omega, this plus r omega by 2r. And so that this value will be omega you will get here. That means the relative angular velocity is also now omega only will get. The angular velocity of A with respect to B is also the same as that of angular velocity of A or angular velocity of B with respect to the center. So, right? So, like that you can calculate the relative angular velocities there. So, next write this problem here. These two particles, write that data. Two particles A and B are revolving along the same circular path, along the same circular path in the same sense, in the same sense. At the given instant, at the given instant, the particles A and B are diametrically, the particles A and B are at a diametrically opposite ends, at a diametrically opposite ends. And angular velocity of A is pi radians per second and its angular acceleration is pi by 2 radian per second square, pi by 2 radian per second square. And angular velocity of B is, angular velocity of B is 2 pi radians per second and is constant. That means B is moving with constant angular velocity and is constant. So that means alpha B is 0, alpha of B. Find the time after which, find the time after which particles A and B collide with each other. Find the time after which particles A and B collide with each other. So now I am taking that in order to find the time after which they will collide with each other. If you are taking relatively, then you can solve this problem easily. Now just I am taking this relatively here. The angular displacement. So that means the angular displacement of B with respect to A. That means we are assuming that if A is at rest, if only B is moving with that relative velocity, then it has to cover an angle of this angle here. That means it is nothing but half of the circle. So corresponding angle will be pi. So that's pi radians it has to cover relatively in order to collide that particle A. Similarly, let us write angular velocity of B with respect to A. Angular velocity of B minus angular velocity of A you can write. And both are in the same sense here. If they are in opposite direction, then minus of minus you need to consider here. And so then this value you can write this expression as 2 pi minus pi you can write. And therefore this is angular velocity of B with respect to A is pi radians per second. And this is radians. And next let us write similarly acceleration is also there here. So let us write the relative acceleration. So acceleration of B with respect to A. So the acceleration of B with respect to A means acceleration of B minus acceleration of A you can write. So that this value we can write this as acceleration of B is 0 minus this is pi by 2. So acceleration of B with respect to A is minus pi by 2 radians per second square. Right? So those are the relative values there. Now that means the particle we are, what we are assuming is particle A is at rest. Now particle only B is traveling with respect to A with the velocity pi radian per second and with the angular acceleration pi by 2 radian per second square. And so then we need to use this kinematic equations to find the time after which the collision is taking place, because we can use the kinematic equations after seeing this value here. If once this alpha value is constant, then you can use that kinematic equation. Otherwise, you can't use that kinematic equation if it is variable, for example. So, we can use that kinematic equation. So, that kinematic equation is nothing but I can write this theta is equal to omega t plus half alpha into t square. This is similar to our s is equal to ut plus half a t square equation in linear motion here. So, in linear motion, we use such an equation. Our corresponding equation, angular motion, we are writing. So now this equation I can write this as theta value is nothing but I can write this as pi. And so then this omega value is also pi into t. and this alpha value is negative, so it is minus pi by 2 into t square, right? And so that I can write this expression as, so pi you can cancel here, so 1 is equal to t minus t square by 4, or you can write this equation as t square minus 4t plus 4 is equal to 0. Is it clear? So you can take an equation like this and you can write this equation as simply t minus 2 whole square is equal to 0. So this is nothing but I can write this t is equal to 2 seconds we can write here. So that is the time after which that particles A and B will collide with each other. So the time after which the particles will collide with each other, right? So remaining these kinematic problems based on the kinematics of circular motion are easy. You can solve those problems easily just by using such equations only, right? And so then let us see next this, what is centripetal acceleration and what is the tangential acceleration in the circular motion, and from that how to calculate this net acceleration here. So just by we introduced the tangential accelerations just now in this beginning of this class. So which is nothing but rate of change of speed of the particle. So now let us write this tangential centripetal accelerations here. Centripetal acceleration and tangential acceleration. So centripetal acceleration. So it is generally represented with AC. Or you can also represent with AN. So the centripetal acceleration is also called as normal acceleration. So just mention that. So you know, whenever a particle is moving in circular path, so the velocity of the particle is changing continuously, because velocity new in circular path, velocity at any point is represented as a tangent along the tangent direction at that particular point. So the tangent drawn to the circle is changing from point to point here. So velocity of this point is also changing from point to point. And so then velocity is variable here. So velocity is variable means definitely one acceleration, that means definitely it possesses some acceleration there. So that acceleration is nothing but we call the centripetal acceleration, which arises because of change in direction of the velocity. The centripetal acceleration arises because of change in velocity of the particle. So then you can mention that when the particle revolves in a circular path, the direction of velocity changes, and so this particle possesses an acceleration which is directed towards the center of the circle, called centripetal acceleration or normal acceleration. So sometimes they will mention that as normal acceleration. Normal acceleration means it will be perpendicular to this velocity direction here. So that means this is the direction of our centripetal acceleration, what we are saying here. So centripetal acceleration will be along this direction and velocity will be along this direction. So this is also called normal acceleration. So you can also represent with AN, normal acceleration. And if suppose let r be the radius of this path here, then the centripetal acceleration is given by, so centripetal acceleration we can write this as so centripetal acceleration or normal acceleration. The centripetal acceleration AC is equal to, you can write this as v square by r. Or you can also write the centripetal acceleration as AC is equal to R omega square. So you can write this as V square by R. Just by using our V is equal to R omega relation. By using that V is equal to R omega relation, you can substitute that expression, or you can also write this as v into omega also you can write. Just we can replace that just by using that v is equal to r omega relations there. And this derivation of this is not required, simply by taking a small angular displacement theta and by writing this change in velocity you can derive this, but that is not required for us. All of you know this formula, I hope, the centripetal acceleration, so that I am not giving any derivation for this. So directly you can use that expression, because you know very well about the centripetal force and centripetal accelerations, right? So there is a centripetal acceleration here. So this centripetal acceleration is always directed towards the center, and we can say that whenever a particle is taking a curve, even it not be a complete circular path, even whenever it is taking a curve, definitely one acceleration will be there here, which is directed towards this center. So it never be zero once the particle is moving in a curved path. So just mention that the centripetal acceleration, centripetal is nothing but, the meaning of centripetal is nothing but seeking towards the center, center seeking. So that means directed towards the seeking, that is the meaning of that centripetal. So write that whenever a particle is moving in circular path or along a curved path the particle definitely possess non-zero centripetal acceleration, definitely possess non-zero centripetal acceleration. That means once the particle is in curved motion, it never be zero, right? There will be some centripetal acceleration directed towards it. And here this value may also be expressed in vector form, like R bar and AC bar are opposite each other. So sometimes if you are writing this in vector form, they will express like this here. Like I can write this as AC bar is equal to minus omega square into R bar. Because R bar is taken away from the center, the direction of the position vector or the radius vector. Now AC bar is directed towards the center. So in vector form, if you are writing this equation, you can express like that. That R bar cross minus of omega square cross R bar, into R bar, you can just write that, right? Just to represent the directions, R bar and AC bar are opposite each other. And so this is the non-zero component of centripetal acceleration there. That means non-zero component of acceleration, and it arises because of change in direction of the velocity. And next I am writing this tangential acceleration here. Tangential acceleration. So which is represented with this AT. Tangential acceleration AT. And so now this tangential acceleration AT is, we mentioned already, this will arise only when there is change in the speed of magnitude. So this centripetal acceleration arises because of change in direction of velocity, and this value will arises because of change in magnitude of this velocity. Whenever magnitude of this velocity is variable, then this acceleration will be there. If velocity is constant, the magnitude of that velocity is constant, then this centripetal acceleration will be, tangential acceleration will be zero. So it may be there or may not be there. If speed is changing, then it will be finite value will be there. If its speed of the particle is constant, then its value will be zero, right? So just mention that the rate of that, first mention about that whenever particle changes in circular path, speed of the particle changes in circular motion, speed of the particle changes in circular motion, then it possesses tangential acceleration. Then it possesses tangential acceleration. And so tangential acceleration is defined as, the rate of change of speed of the particle the rate of change or speed of the particle or magnitude of velocity. That speed is nothing but magnitude of velocity. Magnitude of velocity of the particle. So therefore, tangential acceleration is equal to, these basic definitions are important here. There is only this formula and another relation which we mentioned. So I am writing this as speed means mod of v I am writing, which is magnitude of velocity, or you can say it as a speed. And we already derived a relation between linear acceleration and angular acceleration, like this is at and alpha. So therefore, finally what we can write here is so at is equal to, tangential acceleration is equal to, so dv by dt. So v means, don't confuse here, that is speed, so which is equal to r alpha. So this is a linear acceleration and angular acceleration. This is also called linear acceleration here. So the linear acceleration and angular acceleration relation there. So for this is the only formula. Either sometimes they may give the expression for v. If v expression is known to us, then we use that tangential acceleration is equal to dv by dt. Or if alpha is known to us, then we use that r alpha formula we will use here. So for basic definition, if you remember, then you can calculate this tangential acceleration easily. And so now, as I said, this tangential acceleration may be there in the direction of velocity. This is always along the tangential direction here. By the name itself, it indicates that this tangential acceleration will be always along this tangential direction here. So then if it is this tangential acceleration may be there in the direction of velocity or may be opposite the direction of velocity here. So it's not a compulsory rule that they are in the same direction. So tangential acceleration means it will be tangential to the circular path, so which is also the direction of velocity. The velocity also we are saying the tangential. But these two need not be always in the same direction. Tangential acceleration may be in the direction of velocity or may be opposite the direction of velocity. So if they are in the same direction, then we can conclude that the speed of the particle goes on increasing. And if they are in opposite direction, the speed of the particle goes on decreasing. So that means now here I can mention this as the speed of particle. We can also mention like just mention that if tangential acceleration and velocity are in same direction, if tangential acceleration and velocity are in same direction, if these two are in same direction, you should also observe that alpha and omega will be in the same direction. In brackets mention that. Then alpha and omega, angular acceleration and angular velocity will be in the same direction. So that speed of the particle increases. Speed of the particle increases. If velocity and tangential acceleration are opposite each other, if velocity and tangential acceleration are opposite each other, then speed of the particle goes on decreasing. Speed of the particle decreases. So the speed will be a constant value in this case. And so now that means when at is 0, just I am representing this, and if at and at ac are in the same direction, so this is v bar and at bar, they are in the same direction, then AC will be there along this direction. So in that case, speed increases. Speed increases. So in this case, what I mentioned there is alpha and omega will also be along the same direction. If alpha and omega are in same direction, that automatically indicates that omega value will increase. Once omega is increasing, you know, V should also increase, because V is equal to R omega should remain constant there. And that means that condition is to be satisfied there, because radius of that circular path is a constant value. So that means in that case, this V value will increase like this. Now, whereas if we consider that both are opposite direction there. So therefore, this velocity is along this direction and tangential acceleration is along this direction. Centripetal acceleration is there like this. So now in this case, that speed will decreases. So speed decreases. Right? And the same thing you can also mention in terms of this angular velocity and alpha, as I said, angular velocity and angular acceleration directions. If they are in same direction, they increase, and they are in opposite direction, means decrease. And so, as we are mentioning the two components of acceleration, now these are said to be the two components of acceleration of a particle in circular motion. So, one component is centripetal acceleration, always it will be always present, centripetal acceleration. The other component is tangential acceleration, it may be there or may not be there like this. So, in these two cases, tangential acceleration is there, and in the first case, tangential acceleration is not there. So, right? So, it may be present or may be zero also. So, now let us write the net acceleration general expression there. So, that means now here, net acceleration in circular motion. So, let us write this net acceleration here. So, now this net acceleration means, as we discussed, that in circular motion, two components of accelerations may be there. So, one is called centripetal acceleration, other is called tangential acceleration. This is a centripetal acceleration, this is a tangential acceleration here. So, just mention that when the particle moves in a circular path, when a particle moves in a circular path, it may possess it possess two components of accelerations. It possess two perpendicular components of accelerations. Two perpendicular components of accelerations. One is centripetal acceleration AC. Centripetal acceleration AC, which is always non-zero, which is always a non-zero value. That means which is always non-zero. Or in brackets, simply you may write that centripetal acceleration always AC is equal to, AC is not equal to zero, you may mention that. AC is not equal to zero means once the particle is in curved path, once the particle is taking a curve. If particle is traveling along a straight line, AC may be zero there. We don't define that AC for the linear motion, its value will be 0. Once the particle is in curved motion only, its role will be there. The other component is tangential acceleration. The other component is tangential acceleration. May be 0, it may be 0 or may be non-zero. It may be 0 or may be non-zero. Therefore, net acceleration is this net acceleration is equal to what we can write is, these two are perpendicular components. So, I can write this as AC square plus AT square, you can write. So, that means if these two components are present, then definitely these two components are opposite each other only, because this tangential acceleration will be along tangential direction and centripetal acceleration will be along the radial direction, that means towards the center. So, these two components will be always perpendicular to each other. So, once these accelerations are both are present, then net acceleration is given by the equation. If tangential acceleration is not there, then net acceleration will be equal to centripetal acceleration only, right? And so, then here next, the angle between this net acceleration and this centripetal acceleration, they will ask here. That means this net acceleration, in general, we may represent this net acceleration direction like this. So, that means it lies in between these two. Resultant of this AT and AC, it will rise along this direction here, right? And so, that that net acceleration direction will be along the direction there. In general, we are representing here. Suppose here I am taking this, the angle between this net acceleration and and velocity I am taking here, the angle between net acceleration and velocity. Can you say the possible values? So that means that possible values of that theta. Possible values means simply I am saying that I am asking a question like, can it be zero? Theta is angle between net acceleration and velocity direction. I am saying here the angle between velocity and net acceleration direction. Can it be zero? So net acceleration, it will be zero means net acceleration should be along this direction only. Net acceleration should be along the direction of velocity. See, is it possible to have net acceleration along the direction of velocity? It never be possible in circular motion, because that is possible if AC is equal to zero. But in circular motion, we mentioned already AC never be zero. Centripetal acceleration never be zero. If this value is zero, then only tangential acceleration may be there, and so that the tangential acceleration and net acceleration may be in the same direction. But it never happens in circular motion, right? Because in circular motion, we already mentioned that it never be zero. There is no chance of getting this centripetal acceleration as a zero value in circular motion. So zero angle is not possible, right? Now, is it possible to have the 90 degrees? Now let us think, is it possible to have the 90 degrees? So 90 degrees means that net acceleration should be along this radial direction. Is it possible? Yes. When AT value is zero, we discussed already AT may be zero or may be a finite value, right? See, if AT is zero, then this value will be, net acceleration will be only centripetal acceleration, so that will be along this tangential direction there. So that now that in that case this tangential velocity, velocity and this acceleration are perpendicular to each other, you will get there. Like suppose, so that means if, that is the case here, if AT and AC are perpendicular to, that means AT and we are perpendicular, sorry, parallel to each other, then that will be the case, you will get less than zero. And if they are AT value is zero, then you will get this 90 degrees, you will get the theta value. And can it be, is it possible theta value is greater than zero, greater than 90 degrees? So we mentioned that zero is not possible, 90 is possible. Between zero and 90, any value is possible, depending on that. AC is equal to, that means AC is nothing but centripetal acceleration. Let us write clearly here. So centripetal acceleration AC is equal to V square by R, we can write. So there V is speed at that instant, the speed of the particle at that instant, right? And so next I can write this as the tangential acceleration. So tangential acceleration, we can write this as AT is equal to dV by dt, you can write, or which is equal to R alpha, you can write. So depending on the given data, we use that formula there, either R alpha formula or dV by dt formula you can use. Therefore this net acceleration, we can write this as net acceleration. So therefore this A net is equal to under root of AC square plus AT square, you can write. So is it clear? So that will be the net acceleration calculations there. So then here alpha will be there. Alpha is also non-zero because that omega is variable means. So that alpha, if alpha is given, R alpha formula you can use. Or sometimes they will give the expression for the speed of the particle, then you can use that equation there, right? So this is the, in case of non-uniform circular motion there. And so then this is just we discussed like kinematics of the circular motion. And based on this, I am not discussing the much problems, because you can solve those problems easily just by using the kinematic equations there. And then in the next class, I will start about the dynamics of the circular motion. Like that means I will introduce this force concept there. So till now we didn't introduce that force concept here. So then I will discuss like centripetal force and centrifugal force, and when you need to take the centrifugal force, and those related concepts we'll discuss there, right? Thank you.